Here's Randy Alcorn on the joy of giving.
God's grace is the lightning, and our giving is a thunder that is in response to the lightning. The lightning comes first. We love because He first loved us. We give because He first gave to us. Mm. That's what grace is. So it's in light of His indescribable gift to us that we joyfully give to others, and that's part of being Christ-like.
This is the Revive Our Hearts podcast with Nancy DeMoss Walgamuth, author of Surrender, The Heart God Controls. For November 29th, 2021, I'm Dana Gresh. You know, Nancy, as we enter the Christmas month, I think people are thinking a little bit differently about all the different expenses they'll face, traveling, giving, all the feasting, because many people, their income has dried up this year, and we're facing inflation like we haven't in quite a while, and there's a little bit of fear in the air.
Yeah, there's a lot of change going on, a lot of uncertainty, and, you know, we're not guaranteed financial security in this life. Even
True.
Those of us who are believers are not guaranteed that. And one of the people that has been so helpful to my thinking on how we think about money, how we think about provision, how we think about our resources, is a friend, Randy Alcorn. Over the years, Randy has provided solid perspective on handling good or bad financial news with peace and with confidence in the Lord. In fact, I had the opportunity a number of years ago to interview Randy about a book he's written called The Treasure Principle. This book is a treasure. It's a little book. Mm-hmm. It's worth its weight in gold. It was timely when he wrote it a number of years ago. It's still timely and timeless today. And we felt it was a topic we needed to revisit about how we need to view our resources from God's perspective, and then how giving, even in times of hardship, can be transformational in our spiritual journey.
Well, that makes me excited to hear this interview. So let's listen to Nancy's conversation with Randy Alcorn.
I have to tell you, this is one of those books that I wish I had written. I discovered this book actually shortly after it came out. It's a little book, but worth its weight in gold, more than that. And it's one that has deeply challenged me and many of my friends. So we want to talk this week about what is the treasure principle, and it really relates to your whole life and ministry theme, which is living in light of eternity. Now, the subject of this book has to do with something that some people aren't real comfortable talking about, and that's money and giving. And I sometimes wonder why people aren't more comfortable talking about it, because Jesus talked about it a lot.
He did. Yeah, something like 15% of everything Jesus said related to money and possessions. Look at the stewardship parables. Those alone, he had so much to say about money and possessions. And I think it's because it's so close to our heart. It's so close to our spiritual lives. And spiritual transformation takes place at a level where our attitudes and actions concerning money and possessions are critical. So you look at what happens with Zacchaeus, and here's a man who comes to the Lord and says, I'm going to give away half of all that I have, and I'm going to pay back four times over everybody that I've cheated. And what's Jesus' response? Oh, no, that sounds a little too radical. No, he says, today salvation has come to this house. Now, of course, he was not saved by virtue of these works that he had done, but those works came out of a heart that had been genuinely saved, transformed. And that's how it's supposed to be with us. You know, by grace we've been saved through faith, that not of ourselves is the gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. But then immediately the statement, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. And one of the first good works that comes out of the transforming grace of God in our lives should be giving.
And it's interesting when in Luke chapter 3, when people were asking John the Baptist, what are the evidences of a repentant heart? To each group of people he addressed, he said, the evidence has something to do with how you handle money and possessions.
Exactly.
Yet the subtitle of your book tells a little bit more about it. The title is The Treasure Principle, and then the subtitle is, and I love this, Discovering the Secret of Joyful Giving. Now, for most people, the thought of giving is not something that they necessarily think of as joyful. We think of giving as something we're supposed to do, but not necessarily something that's joyful. And in this book, you help us understand why giving really is a joyful response to the grace of God.
That's right. You look at the beginning of 2 Corinthians 8. Now, brothers, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. Out of the most severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity, and they gave beyond their ability, and they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service, this offering to the saints. The grace of God works in such a way that it produces joy in our lives, and we are so joyful in our giving that we can't get enough of it.
And it's interesting that these Macedonian believers were not wealthy. He says they had extreme poverty, and yet they had great joy and an overflowing heart of generosity. And I love that part you just read where it says they begged earnestly for the opportunity to give. Imagine if we were to go to church and say, I can't wait for the offering. Or imagine, as Randy, you've been a pastor in past years, did you ever have people come to you and say, can you please tell me how I can give more?
Yeah.
That had to be a rare
It was rare. It's been more frequent in recent years where people have read one of my books related to this subject and have come to me and said, I'm really excited about giving. Where can I give? And then to see the joy in people's eyes when you tell them about this opportunity. I had a man recently call and says, I have $20,000 I want to give. Where could I give it? And so I started giving him a menu of stuff. I said, first of all, none of it's going to go to our ministry. I have no vested interest in this. Mm-hmm. So anything that you designate, we will send to the appropriate places, 100% of it. And so now that we've got that out of the way, now you can trust me as I tell you, here are some great opportunities. And so I go through these, some pro-life related ones, some missions related ones, some Bible translation work, prison ministries. And to hear his voice on the other end of the line, like, oh, wow, no, really? Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't even know that that was happening. And just to hear that joy in his voice. And I've had a number of women call, older women who have sometimes inherited a great amount of money, or their husband has died and they have this estate and they're going, well, what can I do with this? And to hear the thrill in their voices when I share these opportunities with them. There is such joy in giving.
And I want to just remind us, as we just saw in this passage, that this passage is not in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 is not just talking about people who had come upon an inheritance.
Exactly.
These were poor people.
Right.
And we probably don't even know what that really means.
Exactly. Yeah, because giving is something that's for everyone. I had someone call me and say, well, you know, I really appreciate this book, Treasure Principle, but I work a lot with people in Cuba, and this is something that I couldn't really share with them. Hmm. I said, well, why? Why couldn't you share it with them? And he said, well, because, you know, they're so poor. And I said, but that's exactly what we're talking about.
Yeah.
It's poor people. And we tend to, without meaning to, rob people of the joy of giving by saying, okay, they're too poor to hear this message, when in fact there is a great pleasure, a great dignity in giving that the Macedonians experience. And that's why it says they pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this offering to the saints. They were obviously, someone was trying to talk them out of it. That's why they're pleading for it. Mm-hmm. Why do they have to plead? And I think the reason is because people are saying, oh, well, you're so poor, you shouldn't be giving anyway. And they say, no, we're not going to stay away from this opportunity to give. It's like in the Old Testament with the offerings taken for the tabernacle, where Moses had to tell the people, go home and don't bring any more money because we have more than enough. But they're going, no, we want to be part of this, because when you really love something, when you want to be part of something, you want to, you know, buy up shares in God's kingdom by giving.
Randy, all this week we're going to be talking about some of the different aspects of the treasure principle and some keys to joyful giving. And let me just ask you to say for us, what is the treasure principle?
The treasure principle is based on what Jesus says in Matthew 6, where he says, don't lay up for yourself treasures on earth, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven. And the old saying is, you can't take it with you. And Jesus recognizes you can't take it with you, but he adds a critical corollary by saying we can lay up treasures in heaven. You can't take it with you, but you can send it on ahead. And that's the treasure principle.
So everything that we have or think we own here on this earth is really just temporary, and we can't keep it. We're going to leave it shortly, and you talk about how that's so much closer than most of us realize and how sad it is that most of us spend our lives accumulating things here on earth and living as if this were the ultimate. But you're really challenging us in this book to realize that we're going to be parting with all these things shortly. We're not going to take them with us. But the treasure principle is that through giving, we can send things on ahead. We can be laying up treasures for ourselves in eternity.
At the end of Psalm 90, the oldest psalm, the Psalm of Moses, he says, establish the work of our hands. And the literal Hebrew translation is make permanent the work of our hands. And that's what giving does. It makes permanent. We give it into God's hands. And when we give it into God's hands, it will last for eternity.
My dad, who's been with the Lord for many years, loved to give. He just never got over the wonder of the fact that God would have saved him. And to him, his whole life was just giving himself and his possessions and his time and any resources God had entrusted to him. He just wanted to give back to God as much and as fast as he could because he felt he owed so much to the Lord. And his giving really was a response to the grace of God. So he was always modeling in our home the grace of giving. But he was also teaching us much about the ways of God in giving. And I can remember him teaching that if you want to know where somebody's heart really is, you want to know what they love, what matters to them, you look at their checkbook and their calendar. You look at what they're doing with their time and what they're doing with their financial resources. And that really is a pretty accurate measure.
That's right. It's like God's grace is the lightning and our giving is a thunder that is in response to the lightning. The lightning comes first. We love because he first loved us. We give because he first gave to us. Mm. That's what grace is. We know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for our sakes he became poor, that we through his poverty might become rich. So it's in light of his indescribable gift to us that we joyfully give to others, and that's part of being Christ-like. And I think of every mother who has the opportunity to model for her children what it means to be a giver, and those children learn by example, They see the giving heart of a mom, and all moms are called upon to give to their children on a regular basis, and there are probably times where a mom doesn't feel like doing what she's doing, and it didn't feel good for Jesus to go to the cross, but he did it, and he did it with the right spirit and the right attitude because it was in the best interests of those that he wanted to bring to himself. And so every mom has the opportunity to have a giving spirit in time and material possessions, but also give the opportunity for her children to see her as a giver to others, where they grow up surrounded in that, like you were in your family. Mm-hmm. You saw models of giving that made giving a joyous and perhaps much more natural part of your environment.
It was, and I'm so thankful for a mom who was willing to follow the leadership of my dad in this area. She would confess that sometimes that was stretching for her, but she was willing to do that, and what an incredible example that was. But what a blessing for me to grow up in a home where I was seeing the heart of Jesus lived out through parents who had such a passion for giving. Randy, in your book, The Treasure Principle, you give several practical keys related to the treasure principle and giving joyously. What's the first key that you talk about in your book?
The first one is that God owns everything, and I'm his money manager. Scripture is full of references to God's ownership. For instance, it says in Psalm 24:1, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Haggai 2:8 says, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, declares the Lord Almighty. 1 Corinthians 6, 19-20 says, you are not your own, you were bought at a price. So right about this time, we're thinking, okay, these scriptures say the gold is mine, the silver is mine, God says the land is mine. And then we think, gee, about the only thing we own is ourselves. And God says, wrong.
Right.
You don't even own yourself. Yeah. You don't own your own body. You are mine twice. One, because you are my creature, I'm your creator. And two, because I am your redeemer and you are my redeemed. I own you twice and I own the title to your life. Mm-hmm. God's ownership of everything in our lives includes ourselves and our family.
So when we're giving to God, we're really giving to Him that which He already owns. I was reading just this morning in 1 Chronicles chapter 29, where in his prayer, David says, "Lord, all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own have we given you." What we're giving to you is what already belongs to you. So it's not ours to share with God. It's God's that He has shared with us, and we're just giving it back to Him.
And David says, who are we? Who am I and who are this people that we would have the privilege of giving to you? He was overcome with the joy of giving. And that is something that unfortunately has been lost in many areas of the Christian community. Mm-hmm. We sometimes view giving as simply a duty, an obligation. And yes, there is duty and obligation in giving, but the emphasis on Scripture is in the pure joy of giving. The fact that it will glorify God, the fact that it will help other people, and the fact that it brings great joy to us.
Now, this whole principle that God owns everything is a really important starting place when it relates to giving. And I think you hit on something that's vital, and that is to realize that God owns us. And that's why in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, when Paul, two great chapters, by the way, on giving, and I'd encourage our listeners, take time today or tomorrow to pick up your Bible and read 2 Corinthians chapters 8 and 9. What a rich teaching there on giving. Paul says, speaking of the giving of the Macedonians, he says they gave themselves first to God, and then they gave their resources. And that's really the appropriate order, isn't it? When we first realize that we belong to God, then it isn't so much a difficulty or a challenge to give our resources to God.
That's exactly right. And that leads into the second treasure principle, which is my heart always goes where I put God's money. Because where Jesus says, don't lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and dust corrupt, where thieves break in and steal. He's saying, don't lay up treasures on earth, not because it's the wrong thing, but because it's the stupid thing, because it's not going to last when you lay it up on earth. Then he says, do lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust don't destroy, where thieves don't break in and steal. And he's saying, so do lay it up in heaven because that's the smart thing to do. So it's not a matter of God not having a treasure mentality. He wants us to lay up treasures for ourselves, but he just says, stop laying them up in the stupid place and start laying them up in the smart place where they're going to last forever. And then he makes that powerful statement, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And I love it when people say to me, which periodically they do, you know, I really wish I had a heart for missions. And it's great to be able to say to people, Jesus tells us exactly how to have a heart for missions or for anything else. Mm-hmm. If you give to it, if you put your money there, and yes, the principle applies to giving your time and giving your abilities to something as well, but in some special way, giving your money and possessions toward a cause aligns you with that cause. Your heart always follows your money, which is actually God's money. And so when you give to something, when you give to missions, for instance, your heart goes with that giving so that you now cultivate a heart for missions. You want a greater heart for your church? Give to your church. You want a greater heart for Microsoft, buy up shares of Microsoft.
Yeah, it really works not just in spiritual matters. And where we're putting our resources inevitably is where our heart is going to be. So if I'm spending a high percentage of my money on clothing or my hobbies, that's what I'm going to be focused on. That's where my heart is going to be.
That's right. If you're a mom that's coaching a soccer team and you're pouring your life into this soccer team and you're spending money and spending your time and all this kind of stuff, now all of a sudden you have this vested interest in kids soccer. And there's an article in the paper about the local soccer league and you are reading every word of it. If your kids weren't involved in soccer, you'd probably completely skip it. You have vested interest in something that you give of yourself to.
So if we want to cultivate a greater heart for God, a greater interest in spiritual matters, how do we do that?
You give to God. You give to God's kingdom. You wish you had a greater heart for God's kingdom, Jesus tells you how to get it. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Move your treasure over to God's kingdom. The more time you invest in studying the Word, in prayer, in giving, in serving, in teaching a Sunday school class, and working in the nursery, the more time you invest in your children's lives, in your relationships with your friends that is oriented toward the things of God, the greater vested interests in God's things you have, and the more eternity-minded you become.
And all of this starts with the realization that God owns everything.
Absolutely.
And I want to challenge our listeners to consider making a list of everything you own, everything that you think you own, all your possessions, your checking accounts, your savings accounts, your vehicle, your clothing, your furniture, your house, personal possessions. Make a list of everything that is in your possession and then lay that list before the Lord and consciously say, Lord, I'm transferring ownership of everything on this list to you. It's all yours anyway, but I'm recognizing that this all belongs to you. And I am simply a manager that you have entrusted with the stewardship, with the responsibility of taking care of these possessions. And you know, you'll find that does two things. First of all, it releases you from fear of losing those things or of them getting broken or stolen because they're God's. And God takes good care of his property. God does with his property what he wants to do with it. But it will also place upon you an incredible sense of responsibility that I have to be careful with how I handle these things, not abusing them, not claiming them as my own, because they belong to God. And you know, as you do, acknowledge God's ownership of everything on that list, including yourself, put yourself, your body, your time, everything that's yours on that list, as you turn it all over to God, there will come with that such a freedom to not cling, to not hold tightly, to let it go, and a freedom to discover the secret of joyful giving.
Everything belongs to God. Isn't there great comfort in that fact? You know, even though Nancy DeMoss Wolgemuth and Randy Alcorn first had that conversation several years ago, it feels so very relevant for today in 2021. You know, God isn't limited by the economy or what happens to the stock market. And I hope the conversation you just heard has been encouraging to you as it has been to me, especially if your personal finances are causing a little fear right now.
And Dana, that's a very real thing for a lot of people. And we have some listeners perhaps who may be out of work or don't have the kind of income that they had before the pandemic. And that's why day after day, we're trying to offer hope and perspective from the scripture that will enable us to stand firm in this shaking world and these difficult times. And you know, even as a ministry, we can be tempted to fear. Revive Our Hearts depends on the donations of friends like you. That's how this ministry exists month after month, year after year. And yet I've reminded myself and our team many times over the years that ultimately the Lord is our major donor with a capital D, that we're relying on Him to provide, which gives us so much comfort and security. The Lord has sustained this ministry over the past 20 years, and He's expanded it worldwide in ways that only He could make happen. If you've ever given to support the ministry of Revive Our Hearts, I want to say again, thank you for your gift. Thank you for partnering with us as we trust God to do a great work in the lives of women around the world. Now, if you've been listening to this program for a while, you may remember that more than 40% of our annual donations is received during the month of December. That makes these next several weeks really important here at Revive Our Hearts. And this year, thanks to what God is doing in women's lives in countries around the world, we have the largest year-end goal of any year in our history. In fact, fasten your seatbelt here. We're believing God this year for $2.8 million in the month of December. But the good news is that about half of that has already been provided in the form of a matching challenge. That means that for every dollar you give between now and the end of December, your gift will be matched one for one. So, God willing, we're almost halfway there. I'm so grateful for those generous friends of the ministry who have already stepped up to provide a significant portion of what we'll need over these next weeks. But we can only take advantage of that challenge if we hear from you and many others like you. So if Revive Our Hearts has been a blessing to you this year, in previous years, if it's encouraged you, if it's strengthened you in your faith, if it's been a blessing to someone else that you know, maybe a family member or friends, if you've shared our resources with others, if you believe in the message and the mission of Revive Our Hearts, then I want to encourage you to consider making a significant gift to help toward this year-end goal. So as we head this week into the month of December, would you start praying with us and ask the Lord how He might want you to participate in what I believe is going to be an exciting thing as we watch the Lord move people's hearts, prompt them to give, and see this need met. Thank you so much for your encouragement.
If you want to give right now, you can visit our website at reviveourhearts.com to make your gift. Or if you'd like to give by phone, call us at 1-800-569-5959. That's 1-800-569-5959. And you know, Nancy, as we've been listening to Randy Alcorn today, I can't help but think that every time I give to Revive Our Hearts, I feel like it's one of the ways I'm practicing the concept of storing up my treasure in heaven.
Yeah, Robert and I feel the same way about giving to Revive Our Hearts and other ministries that the Lord puts on our hearts. Now, if that concept of storing up treasure in heaven sounds a little confusing, you're not sure what it means, be sure to join us tomorrow when Randy Alcorn will be back to explain this incredible life-giving principle. Next time on Revive Our Hearts.
Revive Our Hearts with Nancy DeMoss-Walgamuth is calling you to freedom, fullness, and fruitfulness in Christ.